Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to Prophecy Encounter. We are just delighted to see you all here this evening. For those who are joining us across the country and around the world on the various television networks, we'd also like to extend a very warm welcome to you, in particular 3ABN viewing audience, also the Amazing Facts TV audience. We're delighted that you're part of this international Bible study. Now, as mentioned a little earlier, this series is called Prophecy Encounter. And over the next few nights together, we're going to be looking at some of the most important and some of the most fascinating prophecies in the Bible. There's a lot of material that we want to cover, so I want to encourage you to come out regularly every night. You don't want to miss one of the presentations, because when you study Bible prophecy, you need to build on a solid foundation. And as you study one prophecy after another, they all begin to fit together, and you get to see the big picture of what the Bible is telling us. Now, before we get started in each presentation, we like to have a theme song that we sing throughout the series. So at the end of the series, you're going to be very familiar with our theme song. It's that great gospel hymn, "Lift Up the Trumpet, Loud Let It Ring, Jesus is Coming Again." And we're delighted that Kelly's on the piano and Pablo will be leading us in song. Why don't we stand together as we sing? And our friends who are joining us, you can also sing along wherever you might be.
Remain standing for opening prayer.
Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, what a privilege to be able to gather together to open up your word and study these very important Bible prophecies. I want to invite the Holy Spirit to come and guide our hearts and our minds right here, and also those joining us across the country and around the world. We ask for your special blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Now, this is somewhat of an interactive Bible study, so we're going to give those here in Sanford, Florida, and also our viewing audience, we're going to give you an opportunity to ask a Bible question. If you'd like to ask a Bible question, you can actually text that Bible question. We'll give you the number in just a moment. Or you can go to the Prophecy Encounter website, and there's a place that you can submit a Bible question. And each evening, Pastor Doug Batchelor and Karen, his wife, we'll actually be reading some of those Bible questions and answering them. So take a note at the end of our Bible section this evening. You'll be able to get the information to actually submit your Bible question. So with that, I would like to invite Pastor Doug and Karen Batchelor to come out, and they will lead us this evening with the Bible questions.
Evening. Hello, friends. We are so thankful to be here with you in Sanford, Florida, and to be able to study God's Word together. Now, each night we're encouraging you to send in or ask any Bible-related questions, preferably questions that have something to do with prophecy, because this is the first night we have some questions that people have either sent in through the internet or that we've actually drawn them from other programs, just to kind of prime the pump. But with that, evening, Miss Batchelor. How are you?
Well, good evening, Mr.
Batchelor. I like calling her Mrs. Batchelor.
I like to call her
Mr. Batchelor. She got married and became a bachelor.
And I call him Mr. Batchelor, or Doug, or Dougie, or, but you're not allowed to call him
Dougie.
We're just
glad that you came here tonight instead of watching The Bachelor. You're watching the Pastor Batchelor, so that's good. Okay.
Myself, so now we're in trouble.
Okay.
All right. Our first question tonight is, doesn't Revelation say its prophecies are sealed and should not be uttered?
You might be surprised that there are people who believe that there's some kind of curse or a forbidden whammy that's been put on anyone who reads the book of Revelation. I remember doing a seminar years ago in New Mexico where a couple came in. They looked very frightened. And they told me afterward, our pastor told us that there's a curse on anyone who studies Revelation because the book is sealed. And on investigating, I found out they were referring to a verse that you find in Revelation chapter 10, where it talks about there's one sentence that John hears these seven thunders utter, and God says, don't write that, because that is sealed. It's just one phrase. But the book of Revelation actually says it is a revealing. It's something God wants us to have. Why would he write a book and say, no, don't read it? And there's a blessing in the beginning, first chapter of Revelation. It says there is a blessing pronounced on those who read, hear, and keep the things that are found written in this book. And I can promise you that as you continue to attend this program, that you will experience those blessings because God promised it. And I can't explain how studying prophecy can actually have a positive impact on your marriage and your health and your life, but God promises to bless. And you watch and see if he keeps his word. But I've seen it happen many, many times. It is a revealed book. It's not a sealed book.
Amen. All right. Does Bible prophecy say anything about the religion of Islam?
Yeah, that, of course, this is in the news a lot today. Prophecy does address a number of things. Prophecy does talk about everything from, you know, we're getting ready to have October 31 this year is the 500th anniversary of the Reformation. Prophecy talks about the Protestant Reformation. It talks about Catholicism. It talks about some of the schisms within the church, and it talks about the rise of Islam. Many historians that study Revelation believe that chapter 9 in Revelation is talking about the rise of Islam. And a lot of scholars believe there's also a reference to that in Daniel chapter 11. But yes, I do believe that it is mentioned there, and God willing, we'll be able to say more about that.
Why did God use so many bizarre symbols in communicating prophecy?
Great question. When you read in the prophecies of, you know, let's face it, Revelation talks about a woman riding a beast with seven heads and ten horns. You don't often see a crossing. I've seen in Texas armadillo crossings, and I've seen deer crossings, and we've seen kangaroo crossings in Australia, but I've never seen a crossing that's got a beast with seven heads and ten horns. It's obviously a symbol. You read the books of Ezekiel, Zechariah, Daniel, Revelation. These are the apocalyptic prophecy books. One of the reasons these prophecies are given in symbols is when those books were written, they were often, the people of Israel, were captives of another country. And so the messages that were in those books needed to be coded, if you will. Matter of fact, the very beginning of Revelation, Jesus says in chapter 1 that this message that comes from God to Christ, to the angel, to John, says he sent and he signified it. And that word signified, it's the same word you use for type or symbols. God gave it in symbols, part of it to protect the message. Because Daniel was a captive in Babylon when he had his prophecy, some of his prophecies talked about the fall of Babylon. They didn't like when you said their gods were going to fall in your writings. So one way to protect it is put it in code. Revelation, John was a prisoner of Rome on the Isle of Patmos. The fall of Rome and those things are put in symbols and codes. And so you search and you'll find. Jesus wants us to understand these things.
All right. Well, we have until the sign says 105. So
okay, she's good with numbers. She does our taxes.
Any questions? That's okay. All right. Number 4. Do all Bible prophecies come true? Haven't some of them failed, like Jonah?
Well, the prophecy, and Jonah, you know the book. Jonah went into the city of Nineveh, and he said, in 40 days, Nineveh is going to be judged. And he said that, you know, for 40 days. He went up and down the street saying, 40 days, 39 days, 35 days, Nineveh is going to be judged. But the people of Nineveh repented at the preaching of Jonah. And God doesn't want to destroy anyone. The Bible says he's not willing that any should perish, but that all come to repentance. And so God, he forgave them. The prophecy of Jonah was a conditional prophecy. They were going to be judged because of their wickedness. The Bible tells us God is appealing to us, turn ye, why will you die? He wants us to turn. And so when the people of Nineveh repented, God said, He relented of his judgment. Jonah was actually disappointed. He said, man, now I'm going to look like a false prophet. And God said, I don't want them to perish. And so, no, the prophecies in the Bible never fail. There are some conditional prophecies in the Bible. Nineveh was, by the way, later destroyed because they returned to their wickedness. Mm-hmm. And Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away. My word will not pass away. The thing that God utters always comes to pass. Amen. The wheel of prophecy sometimes turns slowly, but it turns surely. And the things that he predicts will happen.
How can I know God's will for my life?
Now, there's a good practical question we get frequently. You know, there's about a dozen criteria, there's probably more than that, that you can use to determine what is God's will for me. Of course, there's a will of God for everybody that's the same. I just quoted you where God says he's not willing that any should perish in 2 Peter. So that's God's will that you live.
Amen.
But then he has a unique will for people. You know, it may not be your calling to be a pastor or an evangelist, and it may not be my calling to be an artist or a singer. I can assure you it's not my calling to be a singer. We've probably all met people before who thought it was their calling to be a singer. You know what I'm talking about? And so how do you know what God's will is for your life, maybe with a career or a big decision? Karen and I just moved, and we really prayed about where we were supposed to move to, wanted to make sure it was the will of God. So you've got to choose between good choices. First of all, the Word of God will give you the broad principles that you want to follow. So in the Bible. Secondly, the Bible says, in the multitude of counsel, there is safety. Talk to good Christian counsel, people you trust that have wisdom. God speaks through people. Get some good advice. He speaks to us through his Spirit. Sometimes you'll get strong impressions of God's Spirit. Now, don't go by the Spirit if it conflicts with the Word, because the Spirit of God will never lead you contrary to the Word of God. Yeah. Sometimes people say, well, I know I'm supposed to do this, but the Spirit is telling me. You'll see things happen providentially. All of a sudden, a door will close and another door will open, and you'll say, oh, the Lord seems to be leading me through providence in this direction. And so that's just a few steps. It sounds like a shameless promotion. I have a book you can download for free at the Amazing Facts website. Discerning the Will of God. There's about 12 points in there. And a lot of students ask that question because they're getting ready to embark on life. And they're saying, does God have a plan for my life? He absolutely does. Mm-hmm. Sometimes part of knowing God's will is waiting on the Lord, being patient as he unfolds things step by step. He doesn't give us the whole picture all at once. Amen?
All right. Do the prophecies of Revelation have anything to say about the recent political upheaval in American politics and society?
Now, I'll admit, I threw that in there.
But that's a Doug Batchelor question.
I am getting so many emails that are asking questions related to that. They said, boy, there's been such amazing change, even in the last decade, in the American culture and things that, you know, a very volatile political season. As far as the politics, no, I don't think that prophecy specifically dealing with any particular election cycle. Is America mentioned in Bible prophecy or the book of Revelation? I would say yes. And as you continue coming to the seminar, I think that you'll see more how America as a power definitely plays in. I mean, it's hard to miss that America is a world power that has a great religious influence and technological influence and society influence around the world. And it shouldn't surprise you that prophecy references that power and that influence in the last days. So yes, America does. And even some things that are happening religiously and changes, well, I'll say some more about that in the presentation tonight.
Okay. What Bible translation is the best for studying?
Well, of course, this would be my opinion.
What is your opinion for the best Bible study book to translate, to study? You know, let's try that again. What is your opinion?
Issue a declaration that says that this is the version you should study, because I frankly, I came to the Lord I had almost no Bible background, and I first began to read the King James, which now is my favorite, but I've struggled with it. And somebody gave me a modern translation that now looking back, I say it was really a bad translation. But it was so simple that I could understand it, and it was sort of like a kindergarten for me. And when you get into serious Bible study, you want to have a good translation where you're getting accurate truth. Some of my favorite are, as I mentioned, the King James. This is a new King James. It's very similar, except it's modernized some words. New American Standard is good. I sometimes read right now, every morning for my devotions, I read the Bible. I actually have a computer program. I use the Logos computer program. And it reads to me while I read it, and it tells me where I left off every day. And so I go through the Bible. I'm reading the new English version right now. And it kind of gives you a little different perspective, but it's a fairly accurate translation. So you want to have a good translation. You don't want to be using what they call a paraphrase, because I think we all know anybody can do a Bible, and they can, you know, if you got money in a printer, anyone could make a Bible and say, this is the Bachelor version. Heaven forbid, you won't ever see that. But some are paraphrased. People put things in their own word, and they're very inaccurate. Let me give you an example. There is a Bible, since we're studying Revelation, there's a translation out there, I won't tell you which one it is, but when it comes to the mark of the beast, it says the beast power causes everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to get a tattoo in their right hand or forehead. It does not say that or anything like that in the original. And so that's a person's, that was their interpretation they put into it, and I've met a lot of people who read that and they said, yeah, the mark of the beast is a tattoo. So that's really sad, because that's not what it says. And so that's why it's important that you have a good translation. How am I doing on time?
We're doing pretty good. We have one question left.
Okay.
How can we know that the Bible is truly inspired? After all, every religion claims to have inspired writings.
Another good question. Now, this will be something of a personal testimony. Before I became a Christian, well, I wasn't. I was pretty much agnostic or atheist. When I became convinced there was a God, a greater power, last thing I was interested in was Christianity. So I began to study a number of different world religions and read their sacred writings. And you know, you'll find truth in virtually every religion, or it would not be attractive at all. Mm-hmm. The thing is that the devil is a master of mixing truth with error, and that's what makes poison so lethal, is you take some good things, some great principles, and then you put in something that, you know, is totally wrong. So I found some good things in many of the writings of other religions. There's some profound truths. But in a lot of them make prophecies that failed. Some of them share things that I think morally now are just totally wrong. But when I began to study the Bible, and it was sort of the last thing I came to, I was very reluctant. I'll tell you that I grew up in a Jewish family. And we felt, especially the New Testament, and Christians had persecuted the Jews, and I was raised with a lot of antagonism towards Christianity and even the way people use the Bible, so I was very cynical. But I finally started reading the Bible so I could argue with Christians, because I realized I knew nothing about the Bible. And when I started reading it, I realized there is no book like the Bible. Mm-hmm. And as I've studied now for 40 years, the prophecies of the Bible, and seeing how accurate they are, and you'll find out more about that. I think by the end of this seminar, you'll understand very well why the Bible is a standalone supernatural book without any rival to any other writings in the world. Amen. It is a masterpiece. And it is going to be, it'll be the source book, it'll be the textbook for this series.
All right. Well, thank you for answering the questions. And for those of you at home or here in the audience, if you have any Bible questions, you can write them up and send them to our Prophecy Encounter website, or you can text them to area code 760-523-2287. So that number again for text questions is 1-760-523-2287. And tonight our special music is brought to us by local talent of the Orlando area, and it's a singing group called Restoration, and they will be singing "O Love That Will Not Let Me Go." I'm going down.
not let me go. I rest my weary soul in thee.
Amen. Thank you. Restoration. Beautiful, beautiful music. Well, again, welcome everyone. We're glad you're here at our Prophecy Encounter series. It is now my privilege to introduce our speaker for this 10-part Bible study experience, Pastor Doug Batchelor, President and Speaker of Amazing Facts. I don't know if you know this, but he is an author, but also a songwriter. He's written several songs, and we've used some of the songs that he's written for theme songs in different events that we've done. And so we're just delighted that he is here to open the scriptures and share with us. He also hosts a radio program called Bible Answers Live, and it's a live call-in radio program. I have the opportunity to co-host that program with Pastor Doug. And one of the things I can share about Pastor Doug, he loves the Bible. At the end of those one-hour programs, he says, this is one of the best hours of the week for me. I just love studying the Bible and opening the scriptures. So we're delighted that he's here and that he's going to be sharing with us. So at this time, join me as we warmly welcome Pastor Doug Batchelor.
Thank you, Pastor Ross. Evening, friends. We want to welcome you to the Prophecy Encounter, and we're just so thankful that you're here. Matter of fact, just as I was getting ready to come out, they said that there's quite a few people that would still like to come in. We do have an overflow area. If you have any spare seating next to you and the person doesn't look too strange, you might move a little closer to them and free up free up some space, but we're very thankful that you're here. And thank you very much. That'll make a little more room for a few more people to come in. We want to welcome you to this program. This is a special series dealing with principally the book of Revelation. And we're going to be talking about some of the most exciting prophecies, talking about things like 666 and Armageddon, the mark of the beast, the second coming of Jesus, and what is happening in the world through the focal point of prophecy. And I've been sharing seminars like this for about 35 years now, and it is one of my favorite things to do, is just to study the Word of God. Now, I'm more of a teacher than a preacher, and I usually have so much to say, I need to get right into the program because there's a lot of material to cover. People know that something unusual is happening. 2010, the Pew Research Group did a survey. And in that survey, they explained that by the year 2050, about 60% of the people believed that Jesus would come. I think 40 of those 60% were absolutely sure. 20% said probably. And that's in North America, of course. And that's why we're going to be talking tonight about the pinnacle of prophecy and signs of Jesus coming. You know, it's very interesting that they have so many programs now that are dealing with the subject of preppers. National Geographic has a program that specifically talks about doomsday preppers. And a lot of people have been wondering what's coming. And some of these people aren't even religious. They just see what's happening in the world. They're worried about the environment. They're worried about a natural disaster. They say, what will we do if an asteroid strikes, or if there's a tsunami, or if there's a social meltdown? Others are worried about Armageddon, and there's more religious overtones to their fear. But a lot of people are worried. How many of you have heard about folks that are preppers? They're trying to get ready for the last days, and they're storing up buckets of beans, and they've got, you know, solar electric and all these things. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. Karen and I have had a cabin in the hills for 40 years now, and I think 35 years we've been off the grid, and it's just because there's no electricity nearby. But a lot of people are doing this because they think when there's this major meltdown, we somehow will survive. Now, for years, folks have acted like, well, this is just a fringe group that's worried about that. But it's now going beyond that. I think it was just last week, Wall Street Journal published an article that now there's about 60% of these mega millionaires have a plan or a place where they can protect themselves in the event of some social meltdown. You can see doomsday prep for the super rich. They bought these deactivated mission, what do you call, missile silos. And this one developer, Larry Hall, he bought these and he began to develop something so that you've heard of skyscrapers that go up in the air. These go down in the ground. And they have rooms. And it's $3 million for a level. And they are selling out. Because these mega millionaires and billionaires, they're buying secure spots. They've got their own water system purification, air purification, hydroponic farming. They got swimming pool. They've got a theater for 17 people. They got a pharmacy, a jail. And this is all being built below ground. You know, they thought if anybody kind of, you know, gets odd, they've got the jail till they cool off. Because, you know, if you get cooped up with a bunch of type X millionaires, anything could happen. And this is a picture of one of the diagrams of how these are not skyscrapers. They're called earth scrapers because they go down. And they're in Kansas, but they won't tell us exactly where because it's top secret. So it's not just fringe groups that are thinking about some kind of catastrophe that seems to be looming on the horizon. Hedge fund managers, multimillionaires and billionaires from Silicon Valley, they are making preparations for what they think is going to be inevitable one way or the other. And you consider what we're going to study tonight, and you'll see why. So we're going to be talking tonight about signs of Jesus coming. The second coming of Christ is what you would call the pinnacle or the high point of prophecy. And we're going to go through sort of a question and answer method that just helps me stay on track. And so it creates an outline for our study. First question is, what is one of the central teachings in Revelation? Now, you may want to take notes. We've mentioned that there's some supplemental material that you can get to go along with these presentations. But I'm going to give you a few of the scriptures just from Revelation so you'll know that the second coming of Jesus is not an afterthought in the last book of the Bible. For instance, Revelation 1 verse 7, first chapter. Behold, he's coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. Again, you can look in Revelation 1 verse, oh, that's it. And also all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. You can read in Revelation 14, 14. I looked, and behold, a white cloud, and upon the cloud one sat like unto the Son of Man, and having on his head a golden crown. Again, talking about the second coming. Someone on the clouds coming. Jesus is coming in the clouds. You can read in Revelation 22, verse 7. He said, behold, I'm coming quickly. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book. Now, that's the last chapter in the Bible, but we're not done yet. You go to Revelation chapter 22, verse 20. He who testifies of these things says, surely I am coming, how? Quickly. Notice, he's coming quickly, quickly. And you're probably thinking, well, Pastor Doug, John wrote that 2,000 years ago. God's idea of quickly and my idea of quickly are not the same. I mean, we want fast food, and we think our microwaves are too slow, right? So what's taking so long? Well, stay with us, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. He who testified of these things said, surely I am coming quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. One of the principal teachings of the book. So with that in mind, that the Lord says he is coming and that he's coming quickly, what can we know about the time of Jesus' return? Now, this is where you've got to be very careful. And I want you to listen carefully to what I'm sharing. We can know something about the Lord coming soon, but be very careful about a group that is giving you a date for the Lord's return. Matthew 24, Jesus said, speaking of his second coming, but of that day and that hour knows how many people? No man, not even the angels, but my Father only. Now, I'm sure Jesus is in heaven. He knows now. But when Christ was on the, I doubt that the Father is saying, no, I know the date, but I can't trust you with it. But when Jesus was on the earth, he said, I don't even know the date. My Father only knows that. So when someone starts to presume to tell you, I figured it out, I did the math, I know the day and the hour of Jesus coming. This gentleman here, Harold Campion, a very sincere man. I don't question that. He was the president, one of the founders of Family Radio. They have some great Christian music. But I think most of us remember when a few years ago he foretold, I think it was 2011, that was the second or third time he picked a date for the second coming. Matter of fact, one of his dates was, I think, 1994 or 96, I don't remember. I was doing a seminar, and again, he had picked a date, and it really helped the attendance of my seminar. But of course, Jesus didn't come, and I've always made it very clear that's not how you do it. He had a big date for May 21, 2011, and we actually interviewed him. We were on Fox News in Sacramento because I made an offer. He had a great network of radio stations. We said, we'll give you $1 million for your radio stations. You can use now, but if Jesus doesn't come, you sign them over to us. And he didn't do it. And since then, he was sincere. He had a stroke shortly after Jesus didn't come. I think he was devastated. He really believed it, but it messed up a lot of people. And you know what? It made Christianity lose credibility. That's why we've got to be careful about people just continually setting dates, and then it's the next date, and then it's the next thing. I think we need to live in a state of expectancy, because in reality, as far as you're concerned, if you die, your next conscious thought is the resurrection and the second coming of Jesus. He could come for you very soon. And even if you live 90 or 100, 200 years, what's that compared to eternity? Our lives are pretty short. Bible says a day with the Lord is like 1,000 years. Now, Jesus did tell us we don't know the day or hour, but we can know when it's near. Matthew 24, verse 33, he said, when you see all these things, know that it is what? It's near. So Jesus gave us signs. He said, lift up your heads when you see these things. He wants us to be watching. Five times in Mark 13, when Jesus talks about the second coming, he says, watch, watch, watch. Actually, it's four times. But he wants us to be watching. He said, lest coming suddenly, he finds you sleeping. And then he gives the parable of the virgins waiting for the bridegroom. They fall asleep and they're not ready. And so he wants us to be thinking about these things. And so when you come to a program like this and we talk about the return of the Lord, and the closing promise in the Bible talks about, even so, come Lord Jesus, it is a good thing for Christians to talk about Jesus coming back. Amen? It's a good thing. Don't set dates, but he wants us to be looking at that. So, is he coming soon? Let me give you a broad idea of where we are in the scope of history. The Bible sort of outlines history in three great epochs. You've got from the time of Abraham, about 2,000 years ago, from the time of Adam to Abraham is about 2,000 years. We don't know the exact date for creation. Amazing fact, spent a lot of time developing a Bible chronology timeline, just adding up the ages in the Bible, just to know when, you know, David lived, relation to Samson and those things. And when it got back to the time of Adam and creation, you could just make an educated guess. And even if you knew the date, that would not be the way to pick a day for the second coming. Just looking at the scope of history, Adam was born, you don't really say born, he's created, about 4004 BC, somewhere around there. 2,000 years later, Abraham's born. For the first 2,000 years, God shares the gospel through the patriarchs. They were not Jews. They were people like Adam and Seth and Noah, Methuselah, so forth. Enoch, godly people. And then from the time of Abraham, then God shared the gospel for another 2,000 years, especially through the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, and Jesus was born about 4 BC. Now, I know that confuses people. They say, I thought Jesus was born 0. And that's why we say, you know, 4 BC is before Christ. When they developed that dating method, they did an educated guess about when they thought Jesus was born. They fixed that as the year 0. And years later, they found out that King Herod the Great died about 2 BC. We know he's the one who tried to kill all the babies in Bethlehem. Jesus must have been alive then. We realize Jesus was baptized in 27 AD. He was baptized on his 30th birthday, the Bible says. You count backwards and we realize they got that AD-BC dating method wrong. About 4 years. But so then you've got 2,000 years from Adam to Abraham, 2,000 years from Abraham to Christ. Then for the next 2,000 years, which brings us to our day, the gospel's being preached through spiritual Israel or the church. And then after you get from that, and of course we're living now in the space age, you know, we're living right now exactly 2,000 years from the life of Jesus. We're living 2,000 years from between when he was born and when he died. And so it is an interesting time in history. And then you read in Revelation chapter 20, it talks about a 1,000-year period at the end of this 6,000-year of Bible history, talking about the Bible ages, for a total of 7,000, which is kind of an interesting number. You know, the Bible says a day with the Lord is like 1,000 years and 1,000 years like a day. God seems to work on a pattern in the Bible where you work 6 days and you rest one. And here you got like 6,000 years for the plan of salvation. Here we are near the end of that period. And then 1,000 years, it says the saints live and reign with Christ. It's almost like 1,000-year Sabbath, if you will. So just to kind of give this to you in your mind, here I'll put a chart up here. You've got these three epochs. You got 2,000 years of the patriarchs, 2,000 years of the Jews, 2,000 years of the church or spiritual Israel, then 1,000 years where we live and reign with Christ. We're living right at that time. That would be of great interest. I frankly think that we're living in the generation that's going to see the culmination of all that's been foretold. I know what some of you are thinking. Pastor Doug, you pastors have been talking about Jesus coming again now for thousands of years, and it hasn't come yet. When he does come, you'll think it's too soon. And you know what that means? One of these days, one of us is going to be right. He is going to come. Keep in mind, God told Abraham that through his descendants, the Messiah would come. Every Jewish girl hoped that she would be the mother of the Messiah. 100 years went by, 200 years went by. They kept saying, he's coming, the Messiah is coming. 500 years went by, 1,000 years went by. They started losing faith. Yeah, they'd say the Messiah is coming. Finally, when Jesus did come, 2,000 years later, were they ready? Could that happen again? They were on that time. What are some of the signs of the nearness of Christ? This is our question number three. Now, if you've got your Bibles, I don't know if you brought a Bible with you, but I'll read it to you. If you go to Matthew chapter 24, Jesus is talking about signs of the second coming. And he tells us, for instance, several things. First of all, I want you to notice, he says, you go to verse 6, Matthew 24, verse 6. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled. All these things must come to pass. He said, there's going to be war, but a war is not a sign. There have been wars all along. The end is not yet. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And there will be famines and pestilence, those are plagues, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. And they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you. And you'll be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And many will be offended and betray one another, and many will hate one another. Many false prophets will rise and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. And here it promises, but he that endures to the end will be saved. So don't lose patience. Even Revelation says, here is the patience of the saints. Why do you think we need patience? He's coming soon, and some people are saying, oh, is he ever going to come? Hold on, he's coming again. So now let's take apart some of the signs that we just looked at, talking about the signs of the end. Talked about wars and rumors of wars, political instability. Do we have that in the world today? Yeah, you know, just in the news in the last few days, not only is North Korea continuing to push the envelope and test the distance it can deliver ballistic missiles, but Iran is now testing missiles, and they've made it very clear there's some countries they don't like very much. We're one of them. Israel's another. I mean, right now, it's like the whole Middle East is a powder keg. And unfortunately, man has never made a weapon he did not use. That's a historical fact. And you just wonder, at one point, is somebody going to get a hold of a forbidden nuclear weapon from the Cold War, or what's going to happen? You know, Revelation tells us that God has his angels holding back the winds of strife so that the gospel can go forward. I think the only thing that's giving us this window of peace is that the Lord is holding back the winds of strife to give us an opportunity to share the good news while time remains. Wars and rumors of wars. I saw an interesting fact. You know, the world spends over $100 million an hour on soldiers, ammunition, and war machines. And you think about the American military, what it costs every hour, and the Russian, China, these $100 million an hour is spent on preparing for these. Not only wars and rumors of wars, the Bible talked about earthquakes in various places. Not only earthquakes, an earthquake, the one there in 2004 triggered the tsunami, and 250,000 people perished. And everyone keeps saying on the West Coast, when is the big one going to come? And we've already seen some terrible catastrophes with earthquakes. I saw a fact that came from the Geological Society of America and the National Earthquake Information Center that between 2004 and 2014, 18 earthquakes with a magnitude of 8.0 or more rattled subduction zones around the globe. This is an increase of 265% over the average rate of the previous century. Now, while I talk about signs, like war, rumor of war, and plagues, and earthquakes, keep in mind, there have always been these things. What the Lord is talking about is when the frequency and intensity increases. When Karen and I had children, she was great with child. Every now and then she'd get a labor pain. I think they call the early ones Braxton Hicks contractions or something. And, you know, your reaction could be, oh, I'm feeling something, I'll run for the doctor. And they'll often smile and send you home, say, first one, relax, you got a ways to go. And you know, usually that ninth month, they're ready to be delivered. They want to have that baby. But when all of a sudden the pains begin to come closer together with more frequency and they become more intense, then you know there's going to be a baby. And as you near the end of time, you'll see the signs that Jesus talked about, wars. Well, last century we had two world wars. And it almost looks like we're on the brink of a third the way things are going. That's not a normal war. It's a world war. And nuclear weapons and atomic bombs. And the intensity of these things, including the earthquakes and natural disasters, it seems like they increase and intensify. So that's something to keep in mind. Plagues, pestilence, Jesus talked about. I think we all shudder from the terrible images that we saw coming from West Africa with the Ebola breakout recently. But that's not the worst plague. A little more than 100 years ago, in 1918, they had an influenza epidemic, and you know that it killed more people than World War I. About 40 million people died from a strain of the flu. And now with all the antibiotics, science is telling us that the possibility of a very resistant strain, a superbug, could be spread very quickly, because I travel a lot. You get on these airplanes, all it takes is one sick person coughing, and it's pumped through the ventilation system. And boy, the airline industry around the world is a very effective way to spread a virus around the world. And so governments are aware of that, and they are very carefully guarding. You remember with the Ebola, people fly in, they were screening everybody because they could see how quickly this could spread. Again, it's just the grace of God that's holding these things back right now, so that we can find Christ and share Christ. There's things that are happening in the environment. National Geographic released the results of a study where they said that half of the world's wildlife has been lost in the past 40 years. That's staggering when you think about it. But, you know, I've seen it. I told you we have a place up in the country, and we used to see herds of deer. And a lot of these animals that we, you know, Lewis and Clark, when they crossed the Great Plains, they had to wait for a buffalo herd to cross before they could move on. Had to wait 2 days. One buffalo herd. They had flocks of bird that blackened the sky for hours when they went by. They're extinct now. And just a lot of things have changed in the environment. One of the signs Jesus gives of the last days is violence. Christ said, as it was in the days of Noah and as it was in the days of Lot, so will it be in the days when the Son of Man returns. What was it like back in the days of Noah? You read in Genesis chapter 6, the thoughts of men's hearts were only evil continually, and violence filled the land. The Bible tells us it grieved the Lord at his heart that he had even made man. And so you consider that. Do we have that kind of violence in the world today? Here's an interesting fact. Every day, more American youth die in gang violence than fighting in foreign wars. I understand that 2016 in Chicago, there were over 718 murders. That's more people being murdered in one U.S. city than our soldiers were slain in the last 6 years fighting in the Middle East. Violence. One of the signs of the last days. And if you don't mind my just saying here, I don't think it should surprise us when, if you scan through the television, you're going to find people are entertained by violence. And if we're entertained by violence, we tend to reproduce, especially young people. They see hundreds and thousands of murders as they grow up, and you sort of become callous and indifferent. And they see all the shooting on television, and they don't realize the distinction between a real gun and what it's going to do to a life and fiction. And there's just this cold indifference. Immorality, porn. I saw a study not too long ago that is kind of shocking. 12% of all internet websites are pornographic. And there are millions of websites. 12% or 35% of all internet downloads are pornographic in content. 25% of online search engine requests are related to sex. 40 million Americans consider themselves regular visitors to porn sites. The average age for the first exposure to porn is 11 years old. Average age. It's saturating our society. And things that were once considered, you know, immoral, it's just becoming a way of life. People are becoming callous to purity that God is calling us to. And you know, I just can't rush by this without mentioning something I think we're all aware of, that the Bible says, as it was in the days of Sodom, so shall it be in the days when the Son of Man comes. And I'm frankly very disappointed that we've become fuzzy on the distinctions between men and women when it comes to marriage. I don't want to be unkind. I realize it's very politically incorrect to say that, but I'm going to be here and tell you what the Bible says. And the Bible is very clear about that. And so I think that it's unfortunate. But the reason I include that is it is, I believe, a sign of where we are. Who would have thought that 25 years ago? Overpopulation. You know, I saw a study. I actually looked it up to check my facts today. Right now, we're bordering on, 7.5 billion people in the world. It took approximately 5,000 years. I think it was 1829, the world got the first billion people. 5,000 years to get 1 billion. Then it was about 123 years after that, just 123 years to get the second billion. Then about 30 years after that to get the third billion. I remember when there were only 3 billion people, and I'm not that old in the world. And in my life, the world population has more than doubled from 3 billion to 7-something billion. There's actually a website you can go to, and it will clock for you how people are being born, how quickly. It's kind of staggering to just sit there and look at that. How many people? 90 million people are being added to the world's population every year. 90 million people. That's including the ones you deduct for death. 90 million new people drawing on the resources of the planet. Karen, I've been to China a few times. Let me tell you, there's a lot of people in China. I remember in Shanghai. I grew up in New York City. That's a busy city. And it's a very populated city. But I got to China, and I felt like I was driving through New York City downtown for an hour, and it never stopped. Like 24 million people in this one city. But it's growing. And this just tells us it can't last forever. That's why Jesus said, except those days be shortened, no flesh would be saved. But for the elect's sake, those days will be shortened. In other words, if he did not come on time, and if he doesn't cut it short, nobody would survive. So the Lord has to come soon, or there'll be nothing to come for. And another reason I think he's coming soon is everybody's going to believe that Jesus is coming when the whole world just sort of begins to swallow itself. But it may be a little before that, because he said, in such an hour you think not the Son of Man is coming. So it's going to surprise people. And then this for me is one of the most amazing prophecies. We're going to be finding that the book of Daniel is a partner book for Revelation. So we'll be going back and forth. Revelation does a lot of referring to the book of Daniel. You look in Daniel chapter 12, and he says in verse 4, but you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. So no question about what he's talking about. And he goes on to say, many will run to and fro. First of all, I think they're going to run to and fro through the word of God and discover truth. But you can't miss the point that people are running to and fro faster. You realize for about 6,000 years, people, the fastest thing you got is a horse. My grandfather remembers, well, he doesn't, he's passed away, but he was born in New York City. So they rode horses around. One generation. At my grandfather's funeral, he lived in 93. He watched, he saw World War I, he saw World War II, he was born at home, and just can't even imagine the change that's been seen. But as far as going to and fro, look how quickly people travel today. National Geographic back in 2006, I know it's an old article, but it still bears the point. That's the magazine cover, if you want to reference it. There's a quote in there, people are traveling far from home more than ever before in human history. I actually knew a fellow, Northern California. He died 80-something years old, lived 30 miles from the ocean, didn't even get to town until he was 7. Didn't get to the ocean until he was 70. Spent his whole life in, people just didn't go very far. But now, all over the world, people are running to and fro. And Jesus, Daniel goes on to say, in Daniel chapter 12, that prophecy said, knowledge will increase, many will run to and fro, and here's the rest of it, and knowledge will increase. This is a picture here on the screen of the Great Hadron Accelerator. It's the largest experiment in the world. It's the biggest machine in the world. It's under the ground about 500 feet, a 17-mile tunnel in Geneva underneath the ground, where the whole these European governments got together and they poured like $13 billion into building this testing equipment to understand physics. And as they hyper-accelerate these particles, they smash them and then they measure what they find to try and figure out what is the base core of what life is made of. What is the stuff of life? And actually, the nickname is, the machine has been built to discover, they call it the God particle. Have you heard that before? They said it's going to try, we're trying to find the answers of where everything came from. That's a big investment. But what a technology. Not only from under the ground there in Geneva, but up in the sky with the International Space Station, knowledge has increased. Just in one lifetime, or I should actually say in about a century, you look at just some of the changes, incredible inventions, automobiles, airplanes, radio, television, smartphone, computers. A lot of young people today, they can't imagine a world without a smartphone. And, you know, it's, I get... Karen and I got a rental car, and it's a fairly new one. We got lucky, got a low-mileage rental car, and I've nearly wrecked three times trying to figure out how to run the thing. I sat in the car when we got there, and I sat there and said, oh, this is great, low mileage, you know, and I figured out finally you don't have to use a key, you just press the button, because it knows the key's in my pocket. I kept trying to figure out where do I put the key. I'm one of these old people, I want to put the key in somewhere. And I keep taking the key out when I walk up to the car, but it doesn't need the key, it just opens by itself. And I said, what a waste of energy, I had to find it. And I'm trying to figure out how to shift the thing, and I'm looking at all this, and finally Karen reaches over, she turns a knob. Is it like a volume? You shift gears with a volume button. I'm a man, I want to grab something and hear it clunk, you know? When she says, turn a little knob. So it bothers me. Because things have changed. Can you imagine trying to explain a smartphone to the Apostle Paul? He would think you're demon-possessed. Paul would say, look, let me find that in my scrolls. I said, no problem, Paul, I'll Google it. What? Things have changed. And another one for me that I think is a tremendous evidence of the nearness of Christ's coming is global evangelization. Matthew 24, verse 14, this to me I think is one of the most powerful prophecies that really makes me believe we are living in the last days. Jesus said extremely clearly, the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. And then he said, then the end will come. He didn't say it might come or it could come or it may come. He said very emphatically, the end will come. He did not say the gospel will be preached and there'll be a great global revival and everybody will believe. He said, for a witness, give them an opportunity. And then what they do with that opportunity is up to them, but the end will come. Well, is the gospel going in all the world? Just this last 2 days, we've had an invitation to return to China. Amazing Facts was very blessed. We were one of, if not the first Christian organization in over 50 years, invited to preach publicly a whole series of meetings that was broadcast on television in China. And that was such a thrill. And then the neat thing is, they made copies of that, and they continued to multiply that. I just got a call from our headquarters there, and they said, can you come back? And so the gospel, and it's now on satellite. Karen and I are going next month to New Guinea. And they tell us there'll be about 100,000 people at this one meeting that we're going to in New Guinea. We're going to be in Australia. And I'm just one of thousands of missionaries that are out there doing it. It's not like we're doing it. Jesus said the gospel will go to the world. It's going to the Middle East. Amazing Facts gets email from all these people in the Middle East that are watching online. And so people are searching. And the gospel is going, and missionaries are going. And Jesus said, then the end will come. And so we're seeing, I think, the fulfillment of that in this generation. Now, I need to pause at this point and delve into a very important part of our study. I've been talking about signs of Christ coming. Now I want to talk about how he's coming. About what? How he's coming. Because there's a lot of confusion about how. Now, there's going to be a lot of people in heaven that misunderstood how he's coming. Did the apostles misunderstand how the Messiah was coming the first time? Yeah, they'll be in heaven, but they had the scriptures wrong. They thought when the Messiah came, he was going to come on a white horse like King David, and he was going to destroy all of the Romans like Samson or something, and they were going to be a world empire like Solomon, and they just had all these great, glorious ideas about when the Messiah comes. And Jesus said, no. That's when I come the second time. First time I'm coming like a lamb. Second time I come like a lion. Well, the devil's doing the same thing to the church today. A lot of good people are confused about how he's coming, so they won't be prepared to receive him. A lot of Christ's people, the Jews, did not receive him when he came the first time because they said, Nazareth? Who? There's no prophet in Nazareth. And poor carpenter? How can this can't be him? They misunderstood that he was coming first as a sacrifice. Well, now there's a lot of misunderstandings. There are principally three views. When you read Revelation, there's one group they're called preterists. And just think of the word pre. They believe that all of Revelation was pretty much fulfilled by 100 AD. They think Nero is the Antichrist and that it's all behind us. Good people, I respectfully disagree. Then you have futurists. Futurists are the ones who have popularized the version, the left behind scenario, where most of Revelation chapter 4, when John says, I heard a voice and a trumpet, that's all future. Then you have, where I fall in, what they call historists. And I'm in the company, this is used to be the old view. It's not as popular as it used to be, but it's what the Protestant reformers believed. It means Revelation is covering a panorama of history from the first coming to the second coming. And you can kind of track the history of the church and God's people across that horizon. And so I'll just tell you right now, you've got the two main views are the futurist view, there's not as many preterists, and the historic view. The futurist view is a fairly new view. It was really popularized by Hal Lindsey's book. I don't know if any of you remember a book called The Late Great Planet Earth. And in that book, he predicted that because Israel was established as a nation in 1948, in 1981, the secret rapture will take place. In 1988, 7 years later, after 7 years of tribulation, Jesus will come, and none of it happened. And he's still selling books. But it became very popular then. I am with the group that believes that the tribulation comes before Jesus comes. The other group believes that we are caught up before the tribulation. Now, I'd love to believe that, but I don't think it's what the Bible teaches. And we want to know, and I'm going to give you biblical scripture. If you disagree with me, then we can still love and respect each other, but you owe it to yourself to at least understand your brothers and sisters that may believe differently. Amen? And we can disagree and still be agreeable, right? All right, first of all, let's talk about this now. Is it a secret coming? Now, the word rapture means to be caught up. We all believe Jesus is coming, the dead in Christ will rise, we're caught up to meet him. We agree on that. But is it a secret? Is it quiet? Do people just start disappearing and the life goes on for 7 more years on earth after Christ comes? Or after the rapture? I don't believe that. Will Jesus come quietly? Let's look at what the Bible says. 1 Thessalonians 4:16. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. And then it tells us, then the dead in Christ will rise. A trump. You read in Jeremiah 25:30. It tells us, the Lord will roar from on high. He will utter his voice from his holy habitation. He will mightily roar upon his habitation. He will give a shout. And Jesus coming is a very loud event. You read in Psalm 50. If this was the only one, it would be pretty convincing. It says there, our God shall come, and he will not keep silent. And it will be very tempestuous, stormy, round about him. Coming of the Lord is loud, not keep silent, tempestuous around him. And then Jesus, talking about the second coming, he said, for when the Lord comes, said, if they say he's in secret chambers, don't believe it, it will be like lightning shining from one end of heaven to the other. Have you ever seen that kind of lightning that is just so bright that everybody can see it? I remember seeing a lightning storm one time where I closed my eyes and I could still see the lightning flash. I've seen some storms in Texas where the lightning just seemed to go horizontally across the horizon. You could see forever. California, we got mountains. You can't see like you can in Texas. But boy, it was very visible. It's very loud. It's very stormy. It's a great climatic event. And someone might be thinking, well, Pastor Doug, the Bible says he's coming like a thief. Doesn't that mean he's coming quietly? Well, I don't think so. You can read in the Bible where it says in 2 Peter chapter 3, it says, the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise. What happens in the day that he comes like a thief? Notice, heavens pass away with great noise. There's a noise again. And the elements will melt with fervent heat, and the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up. So when Jesus comes as a thief, does it sound to you like life goes on here on earth? He's coming like a thief. That just means it's a surprise. Now, I don't know how much to tell you, but I've not always been a Christian. I used to be a thief. I would break into houses and steal. And right here in Florida, actually, because I used to live in southern Florida. Not your neighborhood, so I don't owe you anything. But I never sent out an announcement and said, I'll be coming, just want to let you know. It was a surprise. And so that's what Jesus is saying. It's going to surprise people, but when he comes, they're going to know. What other physical evidence will accompany the second coming that helps us see it's not a secret coming? Bible tells us there was a, Revelation chapter 16, verse 18, there was a great earthquake such as was not since men were upon the earth, so mighty an earthquake and so great. You go on and read in that passage and it tells you the mountains and the islands are swallowed up. This is no 4 or 5 on the Richter scale. I'm in California. We have earthquakes. And even in Sacramento recently, where we used to never feel earthquakes, we felt some in recent years. Things are starting to get shaky out there. Now, who is going to see Christ when he returns? Is it only a select group that disappears? And listen to what it says. I'm going to give you several verses here. Matthew 24:30. And then shall appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven, and then shall all the tribes of the earth mourn. And they shall see the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven with power and great glory. They're going to see him coming. Great power. Great glory means brilliance, splendor. And again, it says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 30, they'll see the Son of Man coming, power and glory. Revelation 1:7, behold, he comes with the clouds, and every eye will see him. Just to emphasize this, if you, again, I'm just going to look at this real quick. In Acts chapter 1, if you look at verse 9, when Jesus ascended to heaven, he told his disciples, you know, I've got so many of the scriptures on the screen, I like holding my Bible. You read in verse 9, when Christ gave the great commission to the disciples, after he spoke these things, while they watched, he's taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who said, men of Galilee, why do you stand here gazing up into heaven? Notice, this same Jesus who was taken from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go. Jesus was real and personal when he went. The angel said, you're going to see him come. You saw him go. He's left in the clouds. He's coming in the clouds. It's not a secret. We'll see him when he comes. People just don't start disappearing and cars drive off the cliff and planes start to crash and like I said, that's a fairly new teaching. It's about 80 years old, really. All right, number 7. Who will be with Jesus when he comes? He's not coming alone. The Bible says the Son of Man will come in his glory. That's that splendor. And how many? All the holy angels with him. Well, how many angels are there? Let's think about that for a minute. Most of us have a guardian angel. Bible says, Jesus said, speaking of children, their angels do behold the face of my Father, implying that they've got an angel watching them. 7 billion people in the world. God's angels not only watch over people, they're doing his work. They're the ministering spirits. They're the army of God. They're called the heavenly host. Very real creatures with individual personality. Billions of them. Now, one angel came down from God. You read in the Old Testament, in the days of King Hezekiah, the angel of the Lord went through the army of Syria. One angel killed 185,000 enemy soldiers in one day. The angels that were guarding the tomb of Jesus, I'm sorry, when the angels came to the tomb of Jesus at the resurrection, the Roman soldiers that were guarding the tomb were so frightened by the glory of that angel that came down and rolled away the stone, they fell over as though they were dead. One angel. Can you imagine the heaven being filled with the brilliance of billions of angels? He didn't say we're leaving any of them behind. He said all the angels. All the angels have been involved in our salvation. They are going to be very interested in us being redeemed, and you'll see they play a part in our being collected, so to speak. Question 8, what will the brightness of the glory of the Lord's coming and all these angels do to those who are not ready? It says, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angels with him. It says, when Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God. And again, that was 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 and 8. You can read in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8. And then shall that wicked one be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the spirit of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The wicked ones destroyed by the brightness of his coming. And you ever seen when you're out in the field on a nice sunny day and you're just curious, you pick up a stone, you turn it over, and you see all these crawly things start running for the dark. And at night, you can light something out in the woods and all of the moths come to the light. You got two kinds of bugs out there. You got bugs like cockroaches that run from the light, and you got moths and butterflies that love the light. And that's the kind of people you got when Jesus comes. You got your cockroaches and your butterflies. And so those that aren't ready, really, if you don't have the Lord in your life, you are going to be terrified by his coming. But if you love the Lord, the Bible calls his coming the blessed hope. But if you've been living a life of selfishness and sin, it's going to frighten you, and it should. God wants you to have peace, but he doesn't want you to have peace if you're on your way to destruction. He wants you to be troubled until you repent and come to him. The brightness of his coming will destroy them. So what happens to the righteous who are dead at Jesus' coming? First, we'll start with the righteous who are dead. You read there, the dead in Christ will rise first. That's where we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, the voice of the archangel, the trumpet of God. Someone once said that is the loudest verse in the Bible. And the dead in Christ rise first. So does that sound like a secret still? At this point, what happens to the living who are when the Lord comes? The living and the resurrected saints, I should say. So you've got the dead in Christ, they rise. Some of us, we hope to be alive when Jesus comes. I'd like to if I can't avoid death. It's like Woody Allen said one time, I'm not afraid of death. I just don't want to be there when it happens. So most of us are pre-wired by God that we'd like to stay alive, right? So what's going to happen to those who are alive? It says the dead in Christ are raised incorruptible, and those of us who are alive will be changed. In a moment, it tells us, this corruptible will put on incorruption. Corruptible means our bodies, they get old, they decay, they die. We're going to get these glorified bodies, like the kind Adam and Eve had before sin, before the light went out. This corruptible will put on incorruption, and this mortal will put on immortality. Then we which are alive and remain will be caught up together. What direction do we go? That's when it's talking about the rapture. We will be caught up or raptured up together with them in the clouds. We meet the Lord in the air. So Jesus' feet don't touch the ground when he comes next time. We meet him. And Christ said this is how it would happen. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. That's when we're caught up. That where I am, he takes us where? Back to heaven. You may be also, right? So when we are caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and when the dead in Christ rise, and we all go back to the places that God has prepared, what is left here on earth? The wicked are destroyed by the brightness of his coming. How many of you have heard of the 7 years of tribulation? Let me see your hand. You've heard of it. Please show me a verse that says 7 years of tribulation. That's pretty risky to do on live television, isn't it? We're broadcasting on several networks right now. You could shout it out. There is no verse that says 7 years of tribulation. I know where they get the idea, principally from Daniel chapter 9. But the left behind scenario of prophecy basically says that the saints are raptured away. The lost are still here on earth. They've got to go through the tribulation. Then after 7 years of them going through the tribulation, people will have a second chance to repent and come to the Lord. Then Jesus comes back down to earth with the righteous. Some others will still be saved. But then the righteous reign over the wicked. I don't want to do that. For 1,000 years, it's a little bit convoluted. Now, according to the Bible, there's a period of time where no one is alive here on earth. Look in your Bibles in the book of Jeremiah, chapter 4, verse 23. I beheld the earth, and indeed it was without form and void, and the heavens had no light. I beheld the mountains, and indeed they trembled, and all the hills moved back and forth. I beheld, and indeed there was no man, and all the birds of heaven had fled. They're all fled. They had been there. They're gone. I beheld, and indeed the fruitful land was a wilderness, and all of its cities were broken down at the presence of the Lord and by his fierce anger. Cities are broken down. No one alive. Isaiah says the earth is utterly empty. There's no one to lament or mourn the bodies. Why? No one here. In the left behind scenario, they can't explain a time when the earth is basically vacated from the living before God makes a new heaven and a new earth. So moving along, I've got a little more I can say about that in just a moment. The resurrected saints then are caught up. They meet the Lord in the air. Notice, I want to summarize as I talk about the how of Jesus coming. We've read where it says the Lord's coming is literal, personal, visible, audible, physical, vitalizing, glorious, climatic. There's an earthquake. Every sense in your being will know when Jesus comes. You're not going to text someone and say, did you catch it? Catch what? Jesus came with all the angels yesterday. Did you? I missed it. I did notice some planes going down and cars careening off the road, but there was a clump of clothes in the bed next to me when I woke up. I think it was my spouse, but they're gone now. Yeah, I know I'm teasing. Maybe I don't mean to be unkind, but to me, I actually know people who think, well, if I'm not ready when Jesus comes, no big deal. If my spouse, they're Christian, they believe, if they disappear, then I'll get serious. I might have to go through the tribulation, but then I'll know it's true. And you'd be surprised how many people out there are thinking they're going to get a second chance. That's why it's a very dangerous thing to not understand the how of his coming. Another reason is because the devil's got a lot of impersonators out there. By the way, late Pastor Tim LaHaye, who wrote the Left Behind series with Jerry Jenkins, he says in his book, No Fear of the Storm, very honest, no single verse specifically states that Christ will come before the tribulation. He says there's no verse in the Bible that says that. It's a theory. It's a series of fiction books that people are believing is reality. What solemn warning does Jesus give about the second coming? As you start reading Matthew 11, first thing he tells, I'm sorry, Matthew chapter 24, first thing he says is, beware that no one deceives you. He repeats it over and over. Many will come in my name, saying I am Christ, and deceive many. And I remember baptizing a young lady that was in Jonestown with Jim Jones. She escaped just before things all went sideways there and told horrible stories. He started out Methodist preacher, good church, preaching from the Bible, but he was a false prophet. Said ultimately he was Christ. Jesus said, there will arise false Christs. They will show signs and wonders. Are miracles, signs and wonders, the evidence of who's real and who's not? Can the devil do miracles? He can. We'll talk more about that. And they'll do this to deceive, if it were possible, the very elect. In other words, you need to know what the Bible says, because the devil's going to have powerful deceptions in the last days. Some of us remember the Heaven's Gate group, Marshall Applewhite. 39 people believed this poor deranged man who said that he was a reincarnation of Christ, and they needed to commit suicide so they could get on a spaceship that was behind the Hale-Bopp comet. And they took this deadly cocktail. 39 people committed suicide. And he said God was sending messages through Star Trek. Well, there may have been a God sending messages, but it wasn't Jesus. What's going to prevent the righteous from being deceived in the last days? Isaiah 8:20. That's why we want you to know your Bibles. I hope you check on everything I'm saying. You take notes. Bible says, to the law and the testimony. That's how the Bible refers to the Bible. The law and the prophets. If they speak not according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. You measure everything by the scriptures. You need to know. Jesus said, seek and you'll find. Amen? Would it be safe to maybe go see one of these false Christs? You know, just check it out. Jesus said, wherefore if they say to you, behold, he is in the desert, do not go forth. He's hiding behind a comet. Don't believe it. He's not coming secretly. Isn't that clear? Everybody's going to know when Jesus comes like lightning. No one's going to say, I've got inside information. It's a secret. What will the angels do at the second coming of Jesus? They get to participate. Matthew 24:31, his angels will gather together his elect from the four winds of heaven, from one end of heaven to the other. They're participating and gathering together those who are being saved. Since we're now living just before Jesus' second coming, how should we relate to this solemn and glorious event? You know, I don't want people to watch, just tune in to the seminar. By the way, I don't think I ever took a moment to greet the thousands of people that are watching in home groups and church groups right now, gathered around the country. We're so glad you've tuned in. We've seen people register from around the country at the Prophecy Encounter website. But if you're just watching this because you think it's interesting, we do it because we want it to be redemptive. The purpose of prophecy is not to just tantalize us that God knows the future. He knows your future, but he wants you to be redeemed. Jesus said, when these things come to pass, then you will know that I am he. The whole purpose of prophecy is so you can know that he is the one. Have a relationship with Jesus. So how do we relate? Matthew 24, Jesus said, therefore be also ready. He wants us to be ready. For in such an hour as you think not the Son of Man comes, a lot of the world is going to wait until it's too late. It's going to be like that sign they had out in front of the Baptist church. Repent now and avoid the rush. Because when most people finally start believing, it'll be too late. Everybody wanted to get on Noah's Ark after the rain started, right? But it was too late then. Number 16, what will the wicked say when Jesus returns? And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman, and every free man, speaking of the lost, they said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sits on the throne. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? I told you once again, two kinds of people. You have the ones who know Christ, and he's in their heart. You have those who have resisted him, and they've become his enemies. You've either got the love of God or the wrath of the Lamb. I want him to come as my Lord and my Savior, not as my adversary. Amen? Amen. What will the righteous say when Jesus comes? It tells us in Isaiah 25, verse 9, they'll declare, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. Do you live for Jesus? Are you waiting for him to come? You know, there's a lot of things that are probably going on in this massive city here around Orlando and the suburbs. A lot of things going on in the country. A lot of things attracting people's attention. But, you know, I think God is especially interested in what's going on here and via the broadcasts and the streaming, because Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. The most important thing to God is that people find the truth, because the truth will set you free. That you have a relationship with Jesus. You know him. He will forgive your sins. You'll have peace and purpose in your life, and you can live forever. And that's why he wants us to think about this. We get so busy with life, we forget about why we're living. So I'm so thankful that you've decided to take some time to make the main thing the main thing. The Bible says we will be glad and rejoice in his salvation. What is the prime reason for Jesus' second coming? Is he coming to get even with the lost? No, he's coming to redeem his own. John 14:3. I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you might be. Where I am, you might be. Revelation says God himself will be with us. We will see his face. Can you imagine that? Now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. 1 Corinthians 13. What a privilege that we can see God face to face. You know, friends, God is giving us the signs along the way. And I just want you to know that there are some difficult days ahead. I believe there's going to be a tribulation. See, I believe the Lord is coming. I believe we'll be caught up. But I believe the tribulation comes before the rapture. Does God save his people from trouble or through it? Did God save Noah from the flood, or did he save him through the storm? Did God save Joseph from his trials or through them? How about Job? Was he saved from tribulation or through tribulation? Doesn't Paul say it is through much tribulation we will enter the kingdom of God? God is coming for a church without spot or wrinkle or any such things. You get off the spots and the wrinkle with a hot iron and hot water. So the idea that the church is not going to go through any kind of purging or purification before that, when does the church shine the brightest, in the light or in the darkness? There is going to be a time of great darkness. Jesus said it was at midnight the cry was given, "Behold, the bridegroom comes." And so there are some difficult days ahead. I don't worry about that. You know why? God said, if you make the Most High your habitation, you don't need to be afraid. No plague will come near your dwelling. Yeah, we're going to study plagues. By the way, Israel. Did God save Israel from the plagues of Egypt or through the plagues? Were they in Egypt when the plagues fell? But he protected them. So if you've got a relationship with Jesus, you have nothing to fear. By the way, how many plagues fell on Egypt? 10. How many last plagues in Revelation? 7. You realize the last 7 of the 10 plagues that fell on Egypt, Israel was protected through those 7 plagues. First 3, they experienced their trouble with the Egyptians. Last 7, they were protected. God will protect you through the plagues. You don't need to worry about that. What I worry about is, Lord, I want to be faithful. He's given us signs. And some of Christians are losing hope right here on the borders of the greatest event in history. You know, I love history. I remember reading about Christopher Columbus when he was crossing the ocean. You know, he just went launching out. And he said, we're going to go discover a new passage. None of the explorers from Portugal or Spain went very far into the Atlantic because they had rumors you're going to sail off the earth. There were dragons out there and all these scary stories. And he said, we're just going to sail west until we find our objective. And you know, after 2 months in August and September, those sailors were ready to mutiny. And Columbus, you can read his diary, he prayed a lot. He believed he was on a divine quest. He finally told his sailors, give me 3 more days. If we don't see land, we'll turn around. Can you imagine what was at stake? But as those days passed, they began to see signs. Overturned canoe went by. They saw some coconuts flow by, some tufts of vegetation. Water began to change color. Saltiness changed in the water. They noticed when they were sounding that it was getting shallower. Songbirds came by. They couldn't see land, but they saw the signs that they were nearing shore. And they were all encouraged by the signs to press on. Finally, at the end of the 3rd day, at night, they saw a fire in the distance. Next morning, they spotted land, San Salvador. Well, friends, we see the signs. Jesus is about to come. I want to be ready. How about you? I believe he's coming soon. He has a plan for you. And I think he's brought you to this seminar. And we want you to come back. Friends, I'd encourage you to have prayer with your groups. Have a closing prayer. Please do not forget, we have another presentation tomorrow. We're going to be talking about the hero of Revelation, one of the most important presentations, 7 o'clock Eastern time on your time zone. Go to Prophecy Encounter. You can submit your questions there. Continue to pray for the series. And we just thank the Lord that you've come. Amen? We're going to go off the air here praying and asking for God's blessing. Father in heaven, we just thank you for your presence here, for bringing the people and helping us make Jesus' return our priority. We pray that you bless each person, all those who may be tuning in, and pour out your spirit on this event. Help us to sense your presence. We ask all this in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you, friends, and God bless you. Let me take off my mic, and I'll eventually be back there to greet some of you on the way out. Thank you very much.
Okay, friends, let's start with the basics.